Welcome back, everyone. Chairing the third plenary session on economic and trade engagements is Dr. S. Narayan, Head of Research and Visiting Senior Research Fellow at ISAS. Joining Dr. Narayan at the head table are Dr. Iftekhar Ahmed Chowdhury and Dr. Biswa Bhattacharya. I shall now pass the floor to Dr. Narayan to chair the session.
For this session on economic and trade engagements, in the morning we had both the panelists speaking about the extension of relationships between South Asia and Southeast Asia, leading into greater integration of trade and opportunities. And the kind of figures that were mentioned in the morning about the growth of trade between South Asia and Southeast Asia are quite significant, because we are talking of something like a trebling or a quadrupling that has happened in the next in the last 10 years, and an opportunity for increasing it very much more in the coming 10 years, coming decade. And the other feature that is now very visible is the increase of engagement between the South Asian countries and the Southeast Asian countries in the number of free trade agreement as well as regional trade agreement dialogues, which was initially, of course, frowned upon by the WTO. And we have an eminent speaker here who is going to tell us about WTO and ASEAN RTAs, the architecture as well as the rationale and the politics behind it. And with that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Iftekhar Chowdhury, who used to be Foreign Minister of Bangladesh from 2007 to 2009. Before that, as a career diplomat, he held posts of ambassador and permanent representative in New York between 2001 and 2007, and Geneva between 1996 and 2001. At the UN, he was the chairman of a number of committees, including the Social Commission, Population and Development Commission, and was president of the Conference on Disarmament. At WTO, he has chaired the Trade Policy Review Committee and also the Committee on Trade and Development. He has a PhD and a Master of Arts in International Relations from Australian National University, and a first class in Bachelor of Arts Honours from Dhaka University. Dr. Chowdhury.
Those familiar with the laws of physics will be aware that an object is most stable when it rests on three legs. Now, what is true of physics, is that also true of trade? Testing that would be a worthwhile intellectual challenge. The first of the triad that holds up this champion of global free trade, which WTO is, with its near universal membership of 153, with Russia now in the cusp of joining as well, is the multilateral agreement on the trade in goods, including GATT 94 and associated agreements. That's the first leg. The second is the general agreement on trade in services, or what is known as GATS. The third is the agreement on the trade-related aspects of intellectual property, or TRIPS. It's noteworthy that the last two distinguishes it from its predecessor, GATT, the General Agreement on Trade and Tariff, which only dealt with goods. And this has not, however, absolved the WTO from being seen by many as a rich man's club with concomitant, passionate opposition. Like any other member of a multilateral system, the WTO is also governed by certain principles. The first is first of the tripod, the trade in goods, has four basic rules. The first is that it is only through tariffs that protection can be provided to domestic production against foreign competition. And the use of quantitative restriction, though with some exceptions, is prohibited. The second is that those tariffs should be reduced and non-tariff barriers eliminated. And the tariffs so reduced should be bound against any increases. The third rule is that each member must accord all others most favored nation, that is MFN, treatment. Though, as we will see, noteworthy exceptions are provided by the regional trading arrangements, RTAs, that the chair spoke of, and the generalized, also the generalized system of preferences, or the GSP, for the weaker members. The fourth is that no distinction can be made between imported or domestic productions in the levying of taxes or applying regulations, that is, national treatment or NT, must be universally accorded. The second leg of the tripod has to deal with the general agreement on trade in services. Their characteristics, the characteristics of services, that is, are intangibility and invisibility, you can't see or feel, as opposed to the visibility of goods. The WTO has recognized over 150 such services and activities. They range from banking, insurance, telecommunications, to recreational, cultural, sporting, nearly comprising more than 30% today of all contemporary trading. GATS also has a framework for discipline, and these run in four modes in which trade in services take place. These are: mode one is cross-border supply, mode two is consumption within abroad, mode three is where suppliers move to the territory of consumers, and mode four involves movement of natural persons or people from territory of one member to another. The principles of MFN and NT, that is the most favored nation and national treatment, also apply. The third and the last leg involves trade in intellectual property services or TRIPS. The object of intellectual property are the creations of the human mind. Intellectual property rights, or IPRs, pertain to those creations of innovative or artistic works. These cover copyrights, patents, or patents, depending on whether you're speaking English or American, industrial designs, trademarks, and other signs of product distinction that generate consumer loyalty. TRIPS complements other agreements under the World Intellectual Property Organization, or WIPO, which, like the WTO, is also based in Geneva. It covers those aspects of intellectual property issues related to trade and indicates minimum standards and periods for protection that are legally enforceable. As with goods and services, the rules of MFN and national treatment are also applicable. So, the WTO thus constitutes a variety of multilateral legal instruments. It is to be treated as a single undertaking, subjecting all in one stroke to all the provisions, norms, and rules. The responsibilities, however, are varied. Some WTO members enjoy special and differential treatment because of their low level of economic development. In theory, decision making is by consensus. This could at times be irksome, as we now see Georgia holding up Russian membership, for instance. But in reality, the shots are really called by the big players, who are huddled together with the Director General, currently Pascal Lamy of France, in what is called the Green Room. That's the powerhouse of the WTO. Changes to rules and trade are brought about through rounds of negotiations. The current one, called the Doha Development Round, has reached an impasse because of some fundamental differences between the developed and developing countries. The term development in the name, by the way, was meant to mollify the poorer countries, who, however, remain entirely unconvinced as to its genuineness. Everyone pays lip service to the round, but no one seems overly anxious for its conclusion, except perhaps for the WTO Director General and his staff of 640 persons. Unsurprisingly, with the Doha round in limbo, countries are anxious to make the best trade deals they are able to, particularly among the major trading partners. The result has been a spate of regional trading agreements, or RTAs. This is particularly true of Asia now, on whose rising economic clout the attention of the world is focused. To be fair, though, the European Union and the EFTA, European Free Trade Association, must be considered among the earlier and more important RTAs, though with multiple goals, like also the North Atlantic Free Trade Association, NAFTA. This is a lesson that Asia seems to have learned well. Logically, the RTAs that is, appear to erode, and indeed do to some extent, the global principles enunciated by the WTO. But the WTO's position appears to be that if the RTAs are inevitable, one might as well relax and enjoy. Indeed, the WTO allows for such derogation, perhaps designed earlier to fit in the major European and American players. This is through the GATT Articles 24 and GATS Article 5. Though the language has been deliberately kept vague, the Doha round actually endorses those, adding some clauses to underscore transparency. The idea appears to be don't ask too much, don't tell too much. The intertwining agreements are often seen as a spaghetti bowl or noodle bowl in Asian parlance, a phenomena that has sorely perturbed unabashed votaries of pristine free trade like Jagdish Bhagwati, who has called it a fool's way of doing business. Rules require that WTO is notified of RTAs separately for goods and services. Between 2000 and 2010, 31st December, 484 RTAs were notified to the WTO, out of which 293 were enforced. Contemporary RTAs tend to want to broaden and deepen their coverage, becoming more and more comprehensive, including services, investments, trade facilitations, government procurement, intellectual property, electronic commerce, and even labor and environment. Some are bilateral, comprising little more than existing WTO principles, such as the one of Pakistan's according MFN to India that we've heard of this morning. But announced with much fanfare, obviously because of its political implications, and people have called it a tectonic shift in bilateral relations. As I said, the recent attention is now on Asia and the Pacific, given the importance of the region in politics and economics. In consonance with India's look east or engage east policy, India has several FTAs with the regional countries. An important development is, of course, the India-ASEAN agreement, of which we have also heard this morning. This received, as we all know, an impetus recently through the visit of Manmohan Singh to the region and the Bali summit. It's on goods, basically, goods. The trade reaching ASEAN India, as we've also heard, 50 billion and looking to about 72 billion by 2012. But it is services that is key to India, contributing over 55% of its GDP. But Philippines, a strong regional player in the area, is somewhat chary And 10 rounds of talks have not yet broken the logjam entirely. India has also signed not free trade, but comprehensive economic cooperation agreement, as the minister spoke of yesterday, SECA, bilaterally with Singapore and South Korea in 2005 and 2009, respectively. Since then, with Singapore, bilateral trade has doubled to US $17.4 billion in 2010-11. In fact, the SECA with South Korea is more political, evidence that it is more cautious and less tariff slashing than Korea's FTA with, say, for instance, Europe and the US. The latest in the series is the one with Japan, signed in February 2011, and it is said to hold promise, particularly in the important services sector. Within South Asia itself, by the way, SAFTA, the South Asian Free Trade Agreement, is making incremental progress only, though the recent developments between India and Pakistan, as we have heard Mr. Shamsaran say this morning, has introduced a new energy. China has emerged as a major driver in regional FTAs. This despite, ironically, having undergone 11 years of intense negotiations to join the WTO, which it did in 2001. It has since linked up with ASEAN, and thereafter with many others. But their thrust appears political rather than economic, and according to one analyst, less threatening to the world trade system than they appear. Indeed, at the recent APEC summit in Honolulu, Hu Jintao actually endorsed WTO values. When anticipating President Obama's initiative for a Trans-Pacific mega pact, to which China was aloof, as we all know, obviously for political reasons, said, that is who said, we should uphold the multilateral trading regime and deepen regional integration. He actually wanted the Doha round to reap what's called an early harvest agreement within the year, mainly for giving tariff-free and quota-free access to products of least developed countries, or LDCs. Now, this obviously has a political overtone, as LDCs are usually roundly ignored by major FTAs. The big story emerging out of Honolulu was, of course, the new free trade agreement spanning the Pacific called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP. It involves Australia, Brunei, Chile, Malaysia, New Zealand, Peru, Singapore, the United States, and Vietnam. A potential market of 500 million people of booming economies, accounting for 61% of the total export of US goods to the world. And it's described as the 21st century agreement. It includes green technologies and digital economy, and is brought to fruition. If brought to fruition, it will dwarf even the European Union. Japan is said to be interested, but it's for the country that slaps 800% tariff on rice to protect its farmers is difficult to see, though not why, if the goals are political. China, as we know, has not been amused, and it has stated that new mechanism of cooperation to replace an existing one will seriously harm the global economy. The plethora of RTAs is not to deny the usefulness of the WTO, even at these times. First, the WTO does uphold a set of global norms and values. Second, it provides all members, strong and weak, large and small, a platform to deliberate on trade issues of interest to them. Third, its trade policy review mechanism actually renders immense service through peer reviews to sharpen and hone the members' trade policies. Fourth, the theoretical acceptance of the principle that trade is linked to development is a positive global norm. Fifth, the uneven level playing field must be acknowledged in the marketplace is also novel and positive. And finally, WTO does accord effective technical assistance to members that require it. Even if the most ardent proponents of RTA would not negate the WTO and indeed like them to coexist, in fact, the WTO wants to do more. In its latest report in 2011, it has signaled a desire to embrace the phenomena of RTAs and indeed move from coexistence to coherence. This embracing the irresistible, as someone has, as Peter Gallagher, who's an analyst, has called it wise. The PTAs push for the same values as the WTO, and concepts such as facilitating the supply chains, qualifications, accreditation of service providers or investment, WTOs, competition policies are similar to those of the WTO. So in a way, deepening the existing domain of global trade could be termed WTO plus, and widening them to ensure that they cover WTO multiples, formulating appropriate agenda to incorporate all. Now, this accommodation of pragmatism with pristine theory would call for some innovative thinking. The WTO should be in possession of the intellectual wherewithal to master the same. Also, the rising Asia breaks new paths, as the rising Asia breaks new paths in the journey to reconstructing or contributing to a trading architecture more in line with its contemporary aspirations. One is reminded of the Spanish proverb, which says, "Traveler, there are no roads. Roads are made by walking." Chairman, with your indulgence, I'll just take a minute more to reflect a little on this idea of Asian integration and how these RTAs could contribute to it. The Asian experience has been different from European. Europeans have known state system since Westphalia, Agreement 1648, etc., lived 350 years or 400 years through it, and now it's beginning to take another form of unions, which blur borders. In Asia today, also as in South Asia, we are intellectually and politically focused on stressing distinctiveness rather than commonality in order to underscore individual sovereignties. And that's a big difference. Whereas in Europe, Germany, Britain, France have indeed made up their major differences. In Asia, can the Japanese Godzilla, Chinese dragon, and the Indian elephant tango together? Now, this is metaphorically speaking, of course, because tango is something you do with two partners, and here three is a crowd. Nevertheless, the remarkable sense of burgeoning Asianness is there today for all to feel. The phenomena of this resurgence is characterized by the two mega states, India and China, of which we have heard much over the past 2 days. In 1935, a Japanese economist, Kaname Akamatsu, had developed a multi-tiered hierarchical flying geese model to demonstrate how industrialization travels from developed to developing countries. Can the flying geese model from a paradigm be applied to Asia, with larger countries leading and small ones following? Can Asian groupings like ASEAN, SAARC, GCC, and SCO come together someday, albeit very loosely, under the umbrella of an Asian home? Just an idea, but one whose time may have come. As the mighty Rabindranath Tagore said, encouraging initiative, "You cannot cross the sea by standing at its edge and simply staring at the waters." I thank you.
Thank you very much, Iftekhar Saab. I omitted to mention that Dr. Nagesh Kumar has not been able to be present here today. He was to be part of this panel. He's been called away for some urgent meetings in Delhi, and we do miss him. And we have now Dr. Biswanath Bhattacharyay, who is the lead professional infrastructure and advisor to the Dean with the Asian Development Bank Institute. And he's presently task manager of an ongoing ADB-ADBI major study on role of Asian emerging economies, ASEAN, China, and India for sustainable, resilient, and balanced Asia. He has over 35 years of experience in Asia and the Pacific, USA, and Middle East, a PhD from Iowa State University and BS from the Indian Statistical Institute. He has published more than 120 articles and working papers and 18 books on numerous subjects as well as consultancy reports. And I think he brings a multinational perspective to this particular topic of trade and economic integration in South Asia and Southeast Asia. Dr. Bhattacharyay.
At the outset, I'd like to thank ISAS for inviting me for this important event. As a qualifier, I like to mention that these presentations are jointly done by myself and Dean Kawai, our opinion of ours, not for ADB and ADB Institute. So this is our personal opinion and analysis. Now, one of the difficult tasks for the last speaker is that many things you want to say may have been already spoken. So you have to find out how to go and give some new information. So I have some 28 slides, so I may speed up with some slides and someone I can discuss a little more. So later you can go through those slides if you are interested. Now, as pointed out by the chairman, I did a flagship study called Infrastructure for a Seamless Asia, which was done 2009 and is available in website, freely available. So I am, this connectivity is very close to my heart. And then I have done numerous studies on trade integration, integration in services and others. So this is also a very interesting study for me. Now, Dr. Chowdhury talked about the best solution for the world, essentially WTO agreement. Now I'm going to talk about the second best solution of regional integration, which could be a building block for the Pan-Asia and world integration. Now, we did a, last year, we did a conference in Singapore. We bring the people from SAARC region and the people from ASEAN region and let them sit together and learn from each other, and particularly to strengthen the SAARC activities to strengthen the integration in South Asia. So this is kind of a follow-up. And then I did a paper on how to integrate South Asia with East Asia. Now we are more focused on Southeast Asia. So basically in this presentation, we are trying to look what are the prospects and challenges in enhancing trade and economic integration between these two regions, and then how to catalyze the socio-economic transformation of this region through regional cooperation and removal of tariff and non-tariff trade barriers. So what I'm going to do initially, based on our ongoing study, ASEAN, China, and India 2030, I'll give you some bright pictures where these economies can go. And then I talk about how do you achieve there. So here, basically, I look into trade agreements in goods, services, and FDI. Also, very important thing is physical connectivity in terms of hard and soft infrastructure, and then give some policy recommendations. So these are the bright pictures. We have did an analysis, projections, you can say, for 2030. And it shows that ASEAN going to grow in 5.6% for next two decades. And its share of world GDP in PPP will rise from 2.6% to 3.9% by 2030. So that's almost 4%. Per capita GDP of ASEAN as a whole will triple. So now it is $2,639. It will be $6,564 in 2030. Now, as ASEAN, been already presented by Deputy Director General Pushpanathan, that ASEAN is going to be ASEAN community by 2015. So this gives better prospect for higher growth if they can achieve it successfully. I'm just focusing on India. We have data for all South Asia. Basically, India will be growing at a rate of 7.6%. And there are opinion by others who says it may go 8.5%. And each share of world GDP will double by 2030 from 2.5% to 5.5%. And other South Asian countries will grow in the range of 5% to 8%. So South Asia is also a very attractive economy in terms of economic size and populations and untapped potential. Per capita GDP for India also triple from 1229 to 4312. And there are predictions that India might exceed Chinese growth because of this favorable demographic dividends, as 70% of Indian billion plus population are under 35 years old. So if they can utilize the dividend properly, manage it properly, it could be a dividend, or it will be a demographic curse if they cannot manage it properly. There will be, the future is for the middle class. That is the market we are going to be. So there will be 980 million middle class citizens in Asia, and mostly in China, India, and ASEAN. So that's a very attractive market opportunity. And ASEAN and South Asia, 1.7 billion, integrating them can have profound implications for themselves, for Asia, and the world. Now, the main question is, okay, what are the complementarity between South Asia and ASEAN? So basically, as you know, been already mentioned by Dr. Chowdhury, that Asia's become the global factory by joining the East Asian Regional Production Network for manufacturing. So Japan actually started 1960s, it moved to newly industrial economy in 70s, 80s, and then moved to large ASEAN countries like Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia, Philippines, and then it moved to China, and hopefully it will move to India and Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos. So this policy of makes ASEAN a manufacturer-led, export-driven economy. So this is. Now, India actually came late in opening up, and they go away from import substitution, and becoming a giant, and basically, its success on the service sector. So we can say, and also that a huge manpower in South Asia, and this is a young population all over the South Asia, so that could be a complementarity in manufacture-led Southeast Asia and service sector-led South Asia. So South Asia story, you all know that they have done a tremendous integration, and its inter-regional trade was 19% within the region in 1990, and now it is 26% in 2010. And if you look at ASEAN, Japan, Korea, and China, it was moved from 30% to close to 40%. So that's a good story of integration. And if you can see from the chart here that how they have changed over time. Now, you can see for the South Asia is very low and continue to be low within SAARC and South Asia's interregional trade. In terms of ASEAN, it went up, but kind of getting stagnant at 26%. And for ASEAN plus 3, it is 40%. And more or less, prospect is going up because of China. Now, South Asia is considered to be the least integrated subregion in the world, as you see the figures here. And that happened because they didn't follow, like South Asia, outward-oriented strategy. I think the problem of lack of infrastructure and other problem, they have low trade integration and low regional connectivity with Southeast Asia and rest of Asia. So you can say the trade share is as low as 3% in 1990, just over 4% in 2010. So within South Asia is not integrated. And smaller South Asian countries, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, depend on India as important trade partners. And India trade more with countries outside the region. So that's the picture. So lack of openness, high tariff, non-tariff barriers, lack of trade-related infrastructure may have contributed to low level of trade integration in South Asia. And then India has opened up, and that's South Asia, a very attractive market. Now, if you look at South in South Asia's trade, if you can see, it is going up. And 2010, it went almost 70 billion. So it has increased by 15 times from 1990 to 2010. So that's a good prospects. But if you look at interregional FDI inflows, ASEAN, ASEAN plus three have a stronger investment integration, but South Asia, within South Asia and between others, quite low. And if you look at this trade openness and FDI openness, which basically we look at total trade percentage of GDP and FDI percentage of GDP, it is quite low for South Asian country. India, 33% recently in 2009 in terms of trade, only 6% in terms of FDI. But look at Singapore, Malaysia, Laos, even Laos, Thailand, Vietnam, Brunei, quite high in both respects. Now, what I think is that a key factor after I did this study for infrastructure, I found that, okay, physical infrastructure is very important. It's true. But a lot can be done in terms of soft infrastructure, facilitate trade, which is not costly, but more complex in achieving it, which can give you much better results. So first of all, administrative, bureaucratic, and physical bottlenecks. In the export and import supply chains is a key problem. And in non-trade barriers will raise the total trade cost for, this is very high still, South Asia, and also in Southeast Asia, many countries. I will show you shortly the World Bank Logistic Perception Index, and I will show you the openness and market orientation. So this globalization and liberalization are important preconditions for these countries to prosper. Better ICT and better logistics, and growth of South Asian local firms is quite important. And South Asian countries as a whole, and CLMV, this is Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, Vietnam, need to improve the quality of governance, business environment, and ease of doing business. So improving investment climate, infrastructure, and impediments to business and trade, and labor market reform is essential. So this is some, the picture. If you look at overall logistics score done by World Bank, you can see PRC is 30, Thailand 31, India suddenly jumps to 39, lower rank, and then Pakistan, Bangladesh is much lower. Customs, again India from 35, 32 jumped to 47, and Pakistan, Bangladesh is much lower. Infrastructure, again, not significant difference, but a lot of difference. Ease of shipment, there is a difference here. Logistic services, and ease of tracking, and internal logistic cost. It is interesting to see here, Bangladesh is doing better than India in terms of logistic cost, and the timeliness also need to be improved. Now, this is another factor, a level of openness and market orientation. Average import tariff, if you look at, so Japan, 3.4%, Singapore is zero, China, 10%, India, almost 16%, and Pakistan, 15%. Documents for export, I think here China, India, and Pakistan almost doing equally, worse than Japan and Singapore. And time to start a business, again, I think India, China are, not doing so well. Pakistan a little better. Now, I try to see, okay, what kind of, trade can happen between South and Southeast Asia. If you look at the comparative advantage by industry, so I look into 250 industry, it seems the South Asia's advantage lies in processed and paddy rice, manufacturing, mineral, textiles, wearing apparel, plant-based fiber, petroleum, and coal products, whereas Southeast Asia it is number one is electronics, because they join the East Asia's regional production network. Metal products, chemical, rubber, plastic products, coal and gas, and processed rice. So there are some complementarity between these two. And then same time, South Asia has lower cost of labor and low input of cost compared to the major ASEAN countries. Now, we did a study, ADB, to find out what are the impact of trade agreement and successful implementation. If you see the, if you look at, ASEAN and China is something like, 82 billion, and ASEAN plus 3, 214 billion. ASEAN plus 3 plus India, 251 billion. ASEAN plus 3 plus South Asia, 261. So here, India's joining increase the benefits much more. Now, question is, who are doing this cooperation in Southeast Asia and in South Asia? Now, Southeast Asia, there is no lack of institutions doing a lot of work, you can see. There are multiple institutions, and they are doing different work. Now, this is important because ASEAN is very diverse economy. Many countries in a low development stage, capability, so you need to have cooperation with geographical proximity and development stage. So number one is ASEAN, 10 members. It looks into all area, integration, security, trade, infrastructure, and socioeconomic. Then Greater Mekong Subregion, integration, trade, infrastructure, and socioeconomic. Now this is, Greater Mekong Subregion is a very good example of South Asia. Because I remember when ADB started this work, these countries were not in good communications or not in, friends to each other that much. But then, in spite of a large country like China, this prospered very well. And people say in South Asia, the India is too large and is, other neighbors are uncomfortable with India. So if GMS can do it, I think South Asia can do it. And if you look at South Asia, its geographical proximity is much better than even GMS. So this is the example. Then Mekong River Commission, water, here they look into this aspect. Then Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand growth triangle. Then Brunei, Darussalam, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, East Asian growth. And then they are, all of them are performing well. And BIMSTEC obviously have a connection with South Asia and East Asia, but it is not performing that well. It needs to be strengthened. And then we have SARC, and we have SASEC, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, and Nepal. So this, there is no dearth of institution, but the question is how efficiently they are functioning. Now, another way we can have integration with Southeast Asia and South Asia is through East Asia Summit. And this is the picture. ASEAN, India, China, Korea, Japan, Australia, New Zealand. And this arrow shows that India already have comprehensive partnership with Korea and Japan, also with ASEAN, and negotiating Australia, New Zealand, and ASEAN has with everybody. So this could be another way to integrate in a larger market. So the ASEAN is obviously the integration hub and doing a lot of ASEAN plus one. And by August 2011, this year, this almost all ASEAN countries have implemented ASEAN plus India trade agreement, except Cambodia and Laos. And ASEAN, I talked to Dr. Sundaram, and he said that ASEAN and India has concluded trade in services and investment agreements, and hopefully will be implemented next year. Now, India also did bilateral agreement. So you can see the integration is already there. They have SEPA with Singapore, the Malaysia, Thailand, and negotiating with Indonesia, and Pakistan has with Malaysia. So, the bilaterally they are also getting integrated. And then ASEAN plus six and BIMSTEC. Now my question is, can we have a ASEAN plus SARC, a comprehensive agreement? So this is the flying geese, which I explained already. And I think the future for South Asia and low-income Southeast Asian countries are basically lie in expanding and deepening the production network. Now, Dr. Justin Lin, who is the chief economist from World Bank, he has predicted that more than 80 million jobs, the labor-intensive, low-cost job, will go away from China to other economies. So this is a picture which can go to India, Bangladesh, Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos, and they can join the production network. And the production network is very good because the Chinese example, they could move the low productive labor force from agriculture to the manufacture and remove poverty and better standard of living. So this story should continue, and hopefully China and India itself can start their own production network. Now, basically, this production network are MNCs coming from advanced economies. Now, I hope in the future they can start their own production network. Now, come to the factor that how they are performing in terms of human development index, in terms of global competitive index, infrastructure, and doing business ranking. And you can see the high correlation between infrastructure quality, global competitive index, and doing business ranking. So these are the soft infrastructure need to be improved. And Southeast Asia and South Asia has to do that. So as been mentioned by Dr. Pushpanathan, Dr. Sharan, that connectivity is the key for integration. Because ADB did a study and say, even if you have bilateral FTA, most of the business do not use it, particularly SME. They don't found it worth spending time and things. So, but if you have a physical connectivity, the example of Greater Mekong region, you get real benefits. So this is very important. And it's explained that it brings people, goods, services, ideas, innovation, knowledge, technology, and capital closer. Now, ASEAN, we have this study earlier, the South and Southeast Asia need 3.65 trillion infrastructure investment, national and regional projects for next 10 years. So this is huge investment. ASEAN already ahead, they have ASEAN Connectivity Master Plan. They have established recently ASEAN Infrastructure Fund, which will be in Malaysia. But SAARC needs similar arrangements to integrate themselves much better. And I propose a forum between ASEAN and SAARC needs to be established to discuss the cooperation. So this will help low-income and landlocked countries to narrow the development gap. So these are some examples of connectivity. ASEAN Highway, ASEAN Railway, this is going on. And there are this BIMSTEC has several proposals going very slow. ADB is supporting with a lot of assistance and study. Now, one important thing I want to highlight here, for regional integration, you first need national integration. And we did a study to Indonesia. And I am really sympathetic to archipelagic countries like Indonesia and Philippines. It shows only a few Jakarta region benefited from the openness and things because other region had no connectivity and they didn't benefit from the this openness and trade. So very important to connect the countries within themselves very well. Now India has this new project, Delhi-Mumbai corridor, and where they're going to connect 1,483 kilometers with 90 billion cost, and this could be a good model for urbanization because our prediction is by 2030, freight corridor. That's very important aspects. And then importance of Northeast India, Bangladesh, and Myanmar is very crucial. And the encouraging environment in Myanmar and good relation India and Bangladesh gives a good prospect of connecting them. And as been explained earlier, for India, connecting Northeast India to the other part of India, Bangladesh is very crucial. So this, and there are several projects here. So here are the benefits of ASEAN and South Asia. So this will improve the regional demand. And ASEAN, already more dynamic, can contribute to South Asian growth. India offers a very large market for ASEAN. And the economies like Malaysia, Thailand, Singapore need more rebalancing and diversification. And India is an opportunity. And ASEAN-South Asia integration will be a building block for Pan-Asian integration. So it is not against Pan-Asia or world integration. And ASEAN can rebalance its and diversify growth with high export dependence to advanced economies. So my concluding remark is that ASEAN and South Asia, without any geopolitical conflict and strong cultural links with common borders, Myanmar, can produce huge benefits and win-win situation if it can manage properly. And ASEAN-South Asian economy links are growing fast from a small base, particularly driven by India. Now we need, according to my thinking, an ASEAN-SARC FTA and goods and services, and also East Asia Summit FTA, and infrastructure connectivity and facilitation through Northeast India, Bangladesh, Myanmar is crucial, and integration can enhance deepening and expanding of production network. That's the future. But South Asia and CLMV need to lower tariff, non-tariff barriers, improve business climate, attract investment for the regional production network. Now, South Asia integration needs to be enhanced through strengthening SARC for utilizing maximum benefits of the integrations. As I told, that if they are not integrated within themselves, the benefit goes to not all countries equally. And good lessons are ASEAN and Greater Mekong Subregion. And India's role and leadership is critical in consolidating South Asian integration and carrying other South Asian economies as a gateway to ASEAN and East Asia. So South Asian cooperation can go beyond trade, and I have a list, because energy security is going to be a big problem in the future. So we need a lot of free movements of energy across border, like Myanmar has gas, and so this could be crucial. And we need financial cooperation integration to mobilize fund for infrastructure investment. I already show you this region needs 3.6 trillion. So we need to link the financial sector so that surplus fund from one country can move freely to the other country. And ASEAN and SARC have to play a very important role, no question about it. But the last but not least is the political commitment and leadership to cooperation is essential. Thank you.
Two questions for each speaker. First, to Dr. Bhattacharyay, and when you mention about integration, what exactly does it mean? Does it mean connectivity, cooperation, and some others? And how to deepen integration? And to our first speaker, how do you think about the TPP's impact in this region? And should China and India and some other countries participate in TPP? Thank you.
And I gave a big menu to cover many areas. And since the last day we talked about political economy, so my answer is that to avoid political conflict, you make yourself more dependent on each other economically. So it will be very costly to go for a political conflict, because you are highly dependent on each other. So this integration basically could be market-driven integration, like a regional production network, facilitated by the governments and institutions to make business easy and trade. Now, I think that should follow, which I said, why 80 million jobs, as Dr. Justin Lin said, will move away from China, because the cost of labor is increasing, input cost is increasing, and it will go to other Asian countries. Now, also, it may go to the less developed region of China. So this is the market-driven. So multinational corporations need to play a role, and the government need to facilitate and make a right policies and system and procedure at the place. The second part is institution-driven or government-driven integration. So there, the role comes of FTAs, other economic policies, and free movements of goods and services. And there, you can do in different way. So my submission is that connectivity, physical and soft, is very important. And I personally think even important than signing FTA, because
As I said, in our study, ADB, they found SME, they don't use these FTA agreements. And even the large companies, a few, use this FTA. So success of FTA, again, depends on the markets and industry. So we need to have physical connectivity. And the great example I have shown, the GMS, Dr. Wang from China, he knows these very small countries and big country like China, if it can work, the South Asia is possible to work. And then my suggestion is that the economic cooperation, trade cooperation, should be separated with other political discussions and in a different tracks. So you should continue that. And more economic interdependence and integration, this will make more amicable solutions to the other issues, security issues and other will come. So this, the multi-track approach to integration from the market side, from the institution side, from the government side, and as I said, physical infrastructure is important, it is expensive, but in the soft infrastructure, trade facilitation, I gave you so many examples, which could be done without much cost, but is much more complex to achieve. So South Asia and the low-income Southeast Asia need to improve it immensely in short period.
Yes, to Dr. Wong, whether China, India should join the TPP. Of course, these are sovereign decisions of these countries, but my thesis has been that the RTAs in Asia are driven, though there are economic benefits, obviously, as we have seen in these figures, but more obviously politically driven rather than economic. The proponents of TPP argue and say that the Chinese need convincing that it is not a fight but an opportunity. But there is no evidence to suggest that that is happening. In fact, the reverse is what we see. China is seeing this, at least the Chinese media seeing this as a counterbalance to the rise of, or to the perceived rise of China by others, particularly across the Pacific, lending credence to what Andre Gunde Frank had very famously said once, that the thing to most to fear about China's rise is America's reaction to it. Thank you.
I'm a visitor here. I'm a former director of the United Nations World Food Program. A couple of things. First to Dr. Chowdhury. Dr. Chowdhury has been a foreign minister of Bangladesh for a couple of years. Why the Doha round taking so long? Is it the insincerity of the West, or the problems between the, or among the developing countries themselves? And with the recession in the West, both in USA and Europe, and with the serious debt problems, do you see any hope that in the near future the Doha round could be concluded? A second question is to Dr. Bhattacharyay. You have painted, to my mind, quite a rosy picture of the growth and development in South Asia and Southeast Asia. But are they going to trade among themselves? They are not going to trade to the West. And with the current recession in the West, and the debt problem in Europe and in America, would that not negatively affect the growth projections that you have stipulated for South Asia and Southeast Asia? And the second issue, the relationship between South Asia and Southeast Asia. SAARC is no more a new organization, it's rather old now, but it has made very little progress. It's moving forward, not even in snail pace, it's almost static. Probably the main hurdle being the relationship between Pakistan and India being what it is. And there are no signs that that relationship, political relationship, is going to improve in the near future. In that situation, is there any hope for SAARC? Or if there is no hope for SAARC, how do you see a relationship growing between SAARC and Southeast Asia contributing to economic development of this region. Thank you.
It has been said to know what to ask is to know half the answer. The reason it is possible to get some things out of the Doha round to start with. The talk of some low-hanging fruits in the Doha round, what Hu Jintao has also called an early harvest. It is possible to perhaps devise a mechanism whereby you can, for the time being, agree on a set of issues, but the bigger problems are not just between the developed and developing, as we all know, but even among the key players, agriculture remains a huge hurdle. The whole idea that agriculture has a multiplicity of functions, which is held particularly by European countries and challenged by many others, including the United States. So there are serious impediments to total conclusion of the Doha round, but it is possible to reach some agreements on the low-hanging fruit. Absolutely right about SAARC, as one of those both he and I at different levels, of course, at that point in time, were involved with thinking SAARC, when we thought it up in the foreign ministry, initially we called it South Asian Forum, I think, but eventually that was given up. One problem there is perhaps in decision making, the way it was organized. We go through three levels really, and two of these are bureaucratic levels of joint secretaries, levels of secretaries, ministers, and heads. So by the time a document reaches the heads, the hands are really bound, because not just because of this famous Article 10, which does not allow for contentious issues to be discussed, but the value of SAARC, I believe, lies mainly in the corridors than in the chambers. In other words, it's what happens around the SAARC meetings. That is the only occasion where the leaders of our countries get to meet. For some reason, we are not able to take full advantage of the technological connectivity. We don't make telephone calls to one another. But SAARC has, to a very large extent, been very useful in getting the leaderships, at least, together to discuss their bilateral matters. And the retreat is also a very useful forum, not much reflected in the media for obvious reasons, but it has been able to enhance intramural relationship among the leaderships of the region. To that extent, it is useful. I'm not absolutely certain that we have reached the kind of fruition necessary in order to get into some kind of a substantive relationship with another organization like ASEAN or not, but it is well worthwhile an effort. These are intellectual challenges to which we must rise and respond. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
I agree with you that I only give you the rosy picture. In the study, we have actually 9 scenarios, and we call CGE model, computable general equilibrium model, to find out each scenario what is the impact. So one scenario is, as you said, the recession in US and Europe continue for a long time, and then that's a scenario. Other one is basically they will recover with slow growth, and then there will be much more cooperation in worldwide, Asia and the rest of the world. And in the Asian scenario, again, we are assuming that Asia will enhance the productivity, will maintain the productivity and competitiveness, and then they will have more cooperation, expanding the cooperation, Asia-wide FTA, and that scenario is a good scenario. And then we can have lack of cooperation and maybe some trade conflict, and protectionism can come in the advanced economies in Asia. So there are different scenarios. So this scenario, to achieve that, there will be challenges and risk. Several, and we have listed all the challenges and risk. But our conclusion, this is still, I say my conclusion, because study has not been completed yet, is that these risks and challenges can be managed. And what we are assuming, because the there will be reduction of demand from the advanced economy, at least for short term or medium term, Asia need to increase the regional demand and consumption by more integration and more connectivity, so something more endogenous and autonomous region. So that is our prescription. And obviously, you know, China, India, ASEAN, these three economies have to play a very important role, and better allocation of resources, moving the production network in the right places and integrating more country. And so this is the picture here. Now, in terms of the next question, which Dr. Chowdhury has answered well, if you see the ASEAN, I showed you the chart, there are several cooperations in a small group, smaller country, in different functional areas. Now, unfortunately, in SAARC, we have one SAARC, and then you have SASEC, which is also going slow. But I heard that SAARC, in certain areas, like food security, they have good progress, they have done, and there are non-trade area, they have done some good progress. So they have the potential, and the question is how to strengthen it. Obviously, India-Pakistan has to play important role, being the two largest economy. And again, I give example of GMS, Greater Mekong Region. If that can be achieved, why not? So this is possible. So I personally see the, as we have a big picture for India, and then what is already happening, I heard, IT services, India is now subcontracting to Bangladesh. So the production network in service and even agriculture can start, and which can lead to integration within South Asia much better. And similarly, China expanding its production network inside the country and outside the country can do much better. So I think that another important area is bilateral cooperation within South Asia has to be also enhanced. We cannot wait until when SAARC will do. You could see ASEAN, there are so many bilateral cooperation. And, two-country group. So I will encourage this cooperation, which will be building block for whole South Asia integration.
Okay, just want to clarify, because we've talked about South Asia, and to a large extent, what we're saying is that South Asia is held together by India, which is the regional giant. So I'm just clarify with you, is what you're saying is that with India attracting all this investment and the world will attention of the world's investment community, will benefit the rest of South Asia, because things will eventually leave in India will be in a position to benefit the other economies of South Asia. So India's not going to suck away all the investment meant for Bhutan, Nepal, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and it will benefit. There will be a knock-on growth effect for everyone else.
For Dr. Iftekhar, you mentioned just now two mega economies in Asia, and you mentioned China and India. Why are Japan, Korea left out? For Dr. Bhattacharyay, you mentioned the demographic dividend. But the MENA economies also exhibit a similar demographic trend. And today they are in the throes of the Arab Spring. Can you explain the euphoria about the demographic dividend?
My comments from the speaker who asked about SAARC, I refer you to the history of ASEAN, five nations, disparate. But nothing happened for a long time. Five nations into now 10. And there's no question that the momentum has improved, the relationships have improved, the economies have improved. So SAARC started slowly, There are many reasons why it was slow.
Sir, question.
With SAFTA, the recent developments, positive ones, between Bangladesh and India, the other SAARC members, and lately, the very forward-moving outlook by Pakistan has created a new atmosphere. So I am hopeful that this will grow. And as a previous speaker said, that everything will not go into India. Well, there will be a time when India will be looking for...
Sir, do you have a question?
Yeah, no, the question is that, answering to the question that whether there's a hope in SAARC, there is definitely a hope in SAARC.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, well, yes, indeed. The basic philosophy on which SAARC was based is actually some kind of a functionalist approach. The idea was you build cooperation across a large spectrum of smaller activities so that at central levels, the differences will diffuse. The whole idea was to do that. I mean, build linkages across a broad spectrum so that issues at central level are diffused. And slowly, ever so slowly, perhaps it is approaching in consonance with our ideas. With the first speaker, of course, the whole idea of the flying geese paradigm that I spoke of was something like that. You see, I mean, you let the bigger partner grow and try to grow with it. In other words, as the flying geese paradigm goes, drawing your strength from the flappings of the wings of the bird that flies ahead of you. And that is the kind of role that we look to India's playing in South Asia. With regard to mention of China and India and not Japan and Korea, by the way, I did not use the word mega economies, I said mega states. States are different than economies. And you will recall when I mentioned the tango, I brought in Japan. I can make it a quadrilateral and bring in South Korea as well. There is such a dance, is there not, Robin? I can bring in South Korea. But I meant India and China as the mega states and certainly the major protagonists in the current Asian regional politics. Thank you.
Okay, so I think... the first question was, you know, the FDI will come to India and then this will percolate to other economies. Now, Dr. Chowdhury actually answered that question already briefly. But see, what we are seeing in the picture is not that investment all will come to India. Even it will go to, you know, Bangladesh, which is a very, Japanese firms have a survey every year. And they say which are the more prospective countries. Now, Bangladesh was not in top 10 for ever. Now, Bangladesh is one of the top 10 countries who are Japanese multinational corporation destination, and which will be true for China and US, Europe, it will happen. And then Sri Lanka could be a good place for FDI. Now, what will happen is this, what happened to Japan? Why Japan moved out the production to other countries? Because cost of production was too high to do in Japan, so they have to move out. And then Japan's yen become very strong with the Plaza Accord with the US, so they have to move other places. Now, same thing will happen to India, so which is already happening in the IT sector. As I was saying, India is now subcontracting a lot of jobs, programmer level, to Bangladesh and Sri Lanka and other countries. So this is a process which will be market-driven, and then this will go to other countries. But, and to answer the second question, why demographic dividend, and linked with this question, didn't work for Middle East. I happened to work in Qatar Central Bank for 7 years, advisor to the governor. I know the Middle East. I wrote a few articles. So, you know, if you look at China's success story, was utilizing China's demographic dividend. Now, for that, this is only one, issue of the puzzle. You need to have, human development. You need to have technological skill. You need to have conducive policy and environment supporting this kind of processes. So MENA region didn't happen. You know, most of the rich MENA countries are oil-driven countries and they're suffering from Dutch diseases. So they didn't really diversify that much there. So this going to... But Indian situation is also true. You know, basically, as you see China-India comparison, the vocational training in India is much lower than China's level. India has a very large, high-skill manpower, and then very low-skill or no-skill manpower. So this vocational training in India need to be enhanced significantly. And I have to say, labor market reform is very important to attract this FDI to come there, and all other, you know, bureaucracies and, you know, system and procedures, which you see the rank, you know, how far India compared to China and Japan and Korea, is need to be in place. Then they can utilize the demographic dividend. Otherwise, it could be demographic curse. So that is the assumption we made. And as I said, our study says that we have several challenges and risk, but according to us, this can be managed. And we need more cooperation in Asia to be more resilient against these external shocks coming outside from Asia.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhattacharyay, Dr. Chowdhury. I mean, it's been an interesting session in the sense that we've had a lot of positive indicators, and some of these indicators are actually happening in on the ground. So you can see that the way forward, particularly for this region, is going to be fairly stable growth for the next 10 years or so. So on that note, again, I'd like to thank the two distinguished panelists and hand over to our MC.
I would now like to invite Dr. Narayan to present tokens of appreciation to the panel of speakers. Dr. Iftekhar Emma Chowdhury. And Dr. Biswanath Bhattacharya. Thank you, panelists, for your insightful sharing. It is my pleasure now to invite Professor Tan Tai Yong, Director ISAS, to deliver the concluding remarks for the conference. Professor Tan, please.
Colleagues and friends, we've come to the end of the 7th annual conference of ISAS, and we've had a day and a half of very insightful presentations and papers, and also very stimulating discussions. I don't intend to summarize the proceedings of the last 2 days, but what we intend to do is to publish the papers and to bring up a volume as we do with our conferences, so you'll have a chance to read in detail the papers that you heard in the last couple of days. But the theme of the conference is something that we are very interested to pursue. As we've heard from the paper presenters, South and Southeast Asia, lots of very interesting, very core, critical economic, political, security developments happening not only in the two regions but in the individual countries. And also it is in this region, the larger Asia-Pacific region or the Indo-Pacific region, where we're going to see the engagements and the interactions of the major powers, India, China, US, and other Pacific states, that's going to determine very much the landscape of the region and the world. So this is a theme that we are going to pursue in ISAS, and I just would like to take this opportunity to flag three areas where we would like to invest our efforts in. I think first is the need to generate knowledge. We've heard some very interesting presentations, but obviously we also know that deeper analysis would need to be done for us to have a better understanding of the developments in the region, but also of developments in specific countries in the region. At dinner last night, I was talking to Dr. Huang, and he said to me that in China, there are actually very few good scholars working on India. And likewise, as we look around the region, looking for scholars to interact with, people who know China, India deeply, we do not find many of them. So I think the first task that we need to do is to generate an agenda which will allow us to do deep and sharp analysis, and also to do individual studies. As the papers we heard yesterday on the individual countries in South and Southeast Asia, we need to understand what's happening in those specific countries and then do comparative studies and able to learn from each other. So that's the first thing that we need to do. And then the second thing is, of course, we need to create platforms for the sharing of this information. And here we take on a very active publication or publishing agenda at ISAS. And we hope to have more of such conferences and symposia where we can bring together scholars, as you've heard in the last couple of days, to share their insights and the analysis and the studies of developments in the region and in the countries. So this is something that we hope we will do more of. And through these platforms, we will be able not just to sit and hear each other, but to then engage in active collaborative research agendas. And this is something that we're very keen to pursue with a range of partners. And then this leads me to my third point, which is that it is important, I think, now to develop a network of think tanks and research institutes to generate what I think the Governor General of, General of Canada said just 2 days ago, the diplomacy of knowledge, where if we are able to come together to share and study together some of these key developments that we've spoken about, I think this will be an important step forward in developing not only an understanding, but perhaps even useful policies for the regions. And in this regard, I want to share that in ISAS, we are in the early stages of creating a round table, an annual round table, involving cognate think tanks and research institutes from South Asia. So we will work with think tanks in India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, and elsewhere, as well as in Southeast Asia, the individual countries in Southeast Asia. And we hope to have an annual roundtable. We probably will start it off in Singapore, and then we will move it around the two regions, and hopefully that this will allow us a useful platform and a network for us to share and push forward our knowledge of the two regions and how they should interact or how they would interact with each other. So in this regard, I look forward to working with our friends and partners, and I look forward to seeing you all again in one of our future events, and also to thank you very much for your attendance in the last 2 days and for sharing with us your thoughts and your ideas. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Tan. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of the 7th International Conference on South Asia. On behalf of the Institute of South Asian Studies, I thank you for your participation and continuous support for all our events. We value your feedback. Please complete the evaluation form and pass it to us at the registration table. We would like to now invite you to a buffet lunch at Ocean Rooms 1 to 4 on Level 2. Both vegetarian and non-vegetarian dishes are available. Please take the escalator outside the ballroom to Level 2. A list of upcoming events at ISAS for the month of December is also available at the registration counter. We hope to see you at all the events. Till then, on behalf of ISAS, here's wishing you a happy and prosperous 2012. Thank you.